Iceland is large and bleak, 500 miles north of Scotland on the edge of the Arctic. Everyday life for its 200,000 people is hard. This inhospitable environment has forced on the Icelanders a self-reliance and bred in them a fierce independence that sometimes blurs into insularity. This, as much as anything, has motivated a tiny population to confront an overwhelmingly superior power. Huge expanses are completely uninhabitable. Beneath the snow lies unstable volcanic rock, mountains, or vast glaciers. Only on coastal strips do the Icelanders cultivate the usable 1% of their island. Even there, the animals they farm need to share the Icelanders' own characteristic hardiness. But the only benefit from living on an active volcano is an endless supply of boiling water which heats the whole of the capital, Reykjavik, including its open-air swimming pools. Iceland has also harnessed its cold water resources to provide an abundance of hydroelectric power. It's hydroelectricity which powers this aluminium smelter, Iceland's largest industrial plant, and the only major investment in which foreign capital has been allowed. Other nations, particularly Britain, have harvested the same offshore fishing grounds. This dependence on fishing has inevitably made Iceland vulnerable. Her whole economy, and in particular her foreign exchange, are based on the sale of fish or fish products. Of Iceland's export earnings, 3% comes from agriculture, 7% from industry and other products, 15% from that one aluminium smelter, and the overwhelming balance from fish products. The cod accounts for over half of these fish products. For Iceland to lose her earnings from cod would be comparable to Britain losing her revenue from cars, lorries, Scotch whisky, aircraft, and most capital goods. It's an unthinkable prospect. Looking back, many Icelanders consider previous fishing agreements signed with the British to have been as damaging to their economy as the giving away by Britain of a large slice of her rights in North Sea oil. Until last October, Britain was allowed by agreement to take 130,000 tons a year from the rich grounds within 50 miles of the Icelandic coast. Both British and Icelandic scientists have proof that overfishing will wipe out the cod if more than 260,000 tons a year is taken from the sea by anybody. The adult cod population has dropped from 740,000 tons in 1970 to only 210,000 in 1975. Unless the trend is checked, scientists predict it will drop to 50,000 tons by 1979. It may then disappear completely. They point to the Scandinavian herring disaster of the 1960s, which reduced mature stock from 8.5 million tons in 1958 to only 150,000 tons by 1970. Since then, it has all but vanished.
What sort of age is a cod when it is brought in and part of a catch?
As a part of the catch, it is first brought in as 3-year-old, but the trouble is that the cod does not become mature. It doesn't spawn for the first time until it is 7-year-old. So therefore, these immensely effective trawler fleet that are now operating in Icelandic waters are able to fish on it for at least 3 or 4 years before they become mature for the first time, and therefore reproduction is threatened because the cods are so heavily reduced in numbers before they reach the age of maturity.
Now, there's only one answer then, and that is to just catch fewer of them.
Yes, there is just that answer. And I think that there is no disagreement between us or the Icelandic scientist and the British scientist that something must be done.
Let's assume for the sake of argument that nobody else could fish Iceland's waters but the Icelandic fleet. They they themselves would have to catch less, would they not?
Yes, they would have to reduce their catches. We have already advised that, and we have produced reports to this effect. That even the Icelandic fleet alone is excessive at the moment, as the fish stocks are.
In 1958, the Icelanders unilaterally extended their fishing limit to 12 miles in a bid to control their own fishing resources. In 1972, again without international legal backing, they increased this to 50 miles. Finally, last year, they pushed the limit out to 200 miles. Every new limit has brought conflict with the British, though curiously, the latest extension hardly affects the preservation of cod.
The main nursery areas are off the north and east coast of Iceland. Anything up to about 50 miles off the coast. And the main fishing for immature cod takes place between, say, 20 and 50 miles, I think.
So the 200-mile limit is irrelevant, really?
For the cod, there is very little cod caught outside the 50-mile limit. But there are other species that the 200-mile limit is relevant. Especially, say, redfish, which is valuable for the German and the Soviet market.
But to all intents and purposes, all the cod worth catching is inside 50 miles.
Yes, I think more than 90%.
The most significant protests have been made at the most conspicuous target for anti-foreign feeling, NATO's Icelandic Defense Force base at Keflavik, 30 miles from the capital. It's manned by 6,000 Americans and is of the greatest strategic significance in the NATO defense chain. From here, aircraft packed with electronics keep constant watch on Russian air and submarine movements. It was to NATO that Iceland expressed her bitterest complaints about British aggression, and it was fear that she might shut the base that led to the crucial intervention last week of NATO counsel in the Cod War.
Impressed me here in Reykjavik is the time factor. In other words, I am very strongly...
NATO Secretary General Dr. Joseph Luntz was sent to Iceland in the hope of resolving her differences with Britain, as he had done in 1973.
Great, much time left for a happy solution and for an end to this new Cod War.
In the last dispute, you managed to intervene and help bring about further talks between Iceland and Britain, which led to the solution of the earlier Cod War. Do you have the impression you'll be able to do the same thing again?
I do not go as far as saying that I have the impression that I will do it, but I am not without hope. I'm not without hope. And the message I received from Mr. Callaghan, which was very conciliatory in tone, just before I left, has not dimmed that hope.
Sir, may I add to that? NATO has stated that Iceland is important as far as the defense chain is concerned.
Yeah, very important. The response which you have found in all sort of countries.
When he met the press last Thursday, Dr. Luntz made it clear that the security of NATO was his first concern.
Member of the alliance. May I add one other word? You are a huge, unsinkable aircraft carrier. And with these words, I dig leave of you. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Before flying to Brussels for talks with British ministers, Dr. Luntz heard from all sections of Icelandic opinion. He was left in no doubt of the strength of feeling that even 65,000 tons of cod a year, half the last agreed catch, would now be an unpalatably large amount to offer Britain. Editor of Morgenbladet, Iceland's most powerful newspaper and a firm government supporter, is Skirmir Gunnarsson.
Whatever tonnage we give to the British will be taken from Iceland, and 230,000 tons is what we have been taking ourselves in the last few years. If we give you 80,000 tons or 100,000 tons, we ourselves face economic disaster immediately. And if we give you 100,000 tons and continue ourselves fishing 230,000 tons, we face disaster in 1979 or 1918. This is our main problem. We would like to be fair towards the British fishermen, but we simply cannot. We lost the herring 10 years ago, and we are facing the fact that we may lose the cod in 3 or 4 years. And this is no propaganda. We will simply have to move out of this country if we lose the cod. And the British are, under naval force, taking this livelihood from this nation.
Do you think the British government fully understands the conservation message you've been trying to put across?
I don't. I think they don't give a damn. I think they simply don't care. They have their problems. We have ours, and I don't think they care at all. The British government's attitude, or Mr. Hattisley's attitude in the negotiating rounds which were taking place in September, October and November, was such that nobody in Iceland can understand the British government's attitude. Mr. Hattisley was arrogant. He was coming to Iceland saying, well, we have this agreement and we want this agreement again and we want more. And he was asked, well, aren't you prepared to go down from 130,000 tons? And he said, no, what are your proposals? I mean, he was coming to us asking for fish. We were not coming to him asking for something. I don't think you should send Mr. Hattisley again to Iceland.
But it was British arrogance at sea rather than at the conference table which led to an Icelandic ultimatum. Even before Dr. Lund could meet the British, the Icelandic Prime Minister, Geir Hallgrímsson, called a press conference.
Diplomatic relations with Great Britain would be severed, taking force about a week from now, if there at that time still are British naval vessels in Icelandic waters within the 200 miles fishery zone. It is the decision of the British government that ultimately will decide if the severance will come into force or not.
The Morgenbladet leader goes on to say that political opponents are using the fishery dispute to drive a wedge between Iceland and NATO. They're using British aggression to support their case.
The next day's unanimous press support for the Prime Minister was phlegmatically conveyed to the Foreign Office by British Ambassador Kenneth East. No one could later argue that Britain had not been warned.
The prospects are now clear. There will be a diplomatic breach next week unless the frigates are called off the banks within that time.
Away from the diplomatic formalities, the ultimatum last weekend only sharpened Icelanders' determination to defend one of the highest living standards in Europe. As the people at this party told me, it's a standard that could be destroyed by 1 year's unregulated cod fishing.
I think newsmen tend to describe the hectic things, you know, the collisions on the high sea. That's not the main point. The main point, it's a question of fish. It's a question of economic interests. Every ton that the British fish here on the Icelandic fishing grounds have direct influence on the Icelandic economy because we are so dependent on fish. This is why this case is so dear to us, so important.
It's so important that it is worth cutting off diplomatic relations for. It is worth having gunboats in conflict with frigates. It's worth all that.
Oh yes, because I cannot think of any other case who could be as important to us.
Would you be in favour of offering nothing at all to the British?
Yes.
You think they should get out completely?
I realise that this must be very difficult, but I think that the British should have started preparing to get out in 1973. They knew pretty well at that time what the situation was. They must have realised that there isn't enough for everybody in Icelandic waters. They should have made preparations to leave Iceland in 1973. We have now reached the sad state where there isn't enough for everybody. There isn't enough for us, for the Icelanders, whose property, whose fishing grounds these are. And anybody who looks at this problem must realize that these are our fishing grounds. These are part. This is a part of Iceland. This is the only natural resource that we have. This is what has kept Iceland going for whatever it is, 1100 years.
It's also kept places like Hallgrímsson and Fleetwood going.
Yes, I'm very sorry. I'm very sorry. I lived in England for 7 years in Manchester. I realize how serious unemployment is. I think it's one of the most terrible situations any person can be put into. But please don't come to us to alleviate your unemployment situation.
On Monday, the day when Mr. Callaghan was due to meet Dr. Luntz in Brussels, Iceland's 8 cabinet members made their way to the Prime Minister's office in the centre of Reykjavik. Before them were reports laying the blame on the frigate Leander for the most recent ramming of the gunboat Thor. They decided, as the Prime Minister had predicted at his press conference, to give Britain 5 days to withdraw the Navy or diplomatic relations would be cut. This ultimatum caused something of an embarrassment in Brussels, where Mr. Callaghan was informing Dr. Luntz of his decision to withdraw the Navy anyway. But opposition politicians in Iceland are themselves putting pressure on a government they already accuse of being too soft. Jonas Arnesson, MP.
Long ago we should have declared that we would break all diplomatic relations, long ago.
Well, now what would that achieve?
That would achieve, first of all, that people would be taking us really seriously.
But wouldn't it make it that much harder to reach some kind of reconciliation? Why not?
Reconciliation, are you speaking of us allowing them to fish 65,000 tons?
Well, there has to be some sort of deal done sometime, doesn't there?
Well, the deal that we could say that we could accept, when you look at the situation up here, as far as the fish stocks are concerned, is that they shouldn't be allowed to fish a single cod.
Government supporters agree that since November, concessions have become impossible. Would Styrmir Gunnarsson renew the 65,000-ton offer?
No, it's impossible. It's impossible for any Icelandic government to repeat that offer. This government or any other government would not offer the British 65,000 tons again. Your government representatives, they have refused this offer. Have sent in the Royal Navy. They have used force against us in this country. You cannot seriously expect us to what after what has happened that we offer the same figure again. It's impossible, and it is politically not accepted in this country.
On Tuesday night, Prime Minister Hallgrímsson went on to Icelandic television. He is keenly aware that his problems lie not with the British, but with Icelandic public opinion. He promised that gunboats would continue to enforce Icelandic fishing regulations, but that he would meet Harold Wilson when the time came. Tonight it was announced that he is due in London at the weekend. Far from being elated at the removal of the Royal Navy, he was in an uncompromising mood when I asked him about the forthcoming talks.
Have you anything new to say to Mr. Wilson?
Well, not as of today, and I would like to emphasize that it's extremely slim margin we have in any negotiations because of the situation of the fish stocks in Icelandic waters, which are more or less depleted or very near collapsing.
Formally, there was an offer which was made, I think, to the British of 65,000 tons, and that was subsequently withdrawn. Is there any offer now on the table?
No, I don't believe that our discussions will begin with offers from each side. We have to see if we, in general discussions, can provide a basis for some kind of an agreement.
might be difficult for you with the high feeling here to make any concessions to the British government.
That is quite true. That is quite true.
Have you changed at all your instructions to your Coast Guard vessels?
We have declared that Icelandic law will be upheld in our fishery jurisdiction within the 200 miles limit. And I have on that score nothing more to say.
The gunboats duly set out again this week with unchanged orders, though it's likely that both sides will avoid provocation for the next few days at least. But the Cod War is far from over.